And our next distinguished speaker is Mr. Bernard Marx. He's the co-founder and president of Waste Free Ocean in Europe.
Good evening to all, and very first welcome here. I will put my screen up. So let me first welcome you to my home office in the Netherlands. We talk a lot about climate change. I was born and I still live about 1 meter below sea level in a delta area of some main rivers in Europe, where in the 60s of the last century, of course, a lot of pollution from our neighboring countries have arrived, which means that in my country, environmental concern is in our DNA. And of course, the Dutch have a reputation also on the water technologies. First of all, let me also express a welcome on behalf of Alexander Danzis, my co-founder of Waste Free Oceans. And let me share with you a few views on why we started this journey. Both Alexander and myself have a background in the plastic industry, on plastic converting and plastic recycling. The former speaker already said we are part of the future, so I'm glad that future for me already started 30 years ago. I'm one of the front runners in the European scene on this topic. I have run and built recycling plants and converting plants in many countries, and always with the idea of using recyclate as a raw material as much as we can on as much high recycling content as possible. Our journey started basically about already 20, 25 years ago when we started to discuss with the European policymakers on improved waste management and improved waste legislation, like the Waste Framework Directive, etc. I've had the honor of being the chairman of the Plastic Recyclers Association for the European Union for 12 years, and I'm their honorary president since 2011. And then we came to a discussion about plastics floating around in the marine environment. And over a dinner, some leading people in the European industry said, listen, as you step down as president of Recyclers, you have so much knowledge and you're going to be bored, so you need a new hobby. So why don't you start looking at the marine environment and what can we do as an industry and industry partners to be part of a solution? This resulted in the foundation, which we called Waste Free Ocean. And let me share with you why we do it and what we have achieved together with a lot of our partners. So let me see how I can move my screen. Ah, there it goes. So basically, there are a few topics where we look at. We organize cleanups. And one of the first ideas is to use the fishermen of the European community to be part of a solution by bringing back not only fish, but also waste on land when it's escaped the level. That was, of course, in the early days when nobody knew so much about it. Today, we know that the fight is really actually on land and we have to stop the inflow more and more. Then, of course, to create iconic products by even showing that if it's escaped and we bring it back, we can still make very high quality products out of it. And of course, prevention and reuse and better collection on land is the key to success. And most important, of course, start raising education issues and awareness things where we can. Here, a brief thing. This is a kickoff in Barcelona in 2011 in Spain with local fishermen, small scale fishermen, who actually helped us to do the first cleanups in the port and around the sea base of the beaches there. We have developed floatable and inflatable trawls, which have been developed by fishermen to actually collect waste, which are used both in motion and also on stationary levels. Here's some lens at it. Can we clean the world with this? No, of course not. But it also raised awareness in the blue economy and in the maritime sector. It also, as you may know, in the maritime sector, the blue shelf is a known expression, which means if you have a waste stream, just tip it overboard. So we have to stop and close the blue shelf. And by doing these kind of activities and by cleaning up, we came closer and closer to the fishing community. Here you see we work with the dredging companies also. The four largest dredging companies in the world are based in the Benelux. So they were about a few hours from our home. We work with fishing communities and they are proud to be part of a solution. And I think this is also showing you the journey. When we started in 2011, you cannot imagine it. Nobody talked about microplastic. Today it's in the news every day. Yeah. In recent years, Europe has launched a lot of new legislation. Here just a few of them. One very important one is the circular economy package, which is part of the discussion we have today. But also, for example, what is the role for a port? What is the role for packaging, single-use packaging? Of course, we find a lot in litter. And in there, we also see a directive on fishing gear, which is in the top 10 most littered items. It was already expressed by the former speaker. Recycling is turning a waste stream into a value raw material. It is not energy recovery. It is not a backfilling operations in road construction. It is to keep the material in a material loop. The other things are important, but they're not recycling. And I think, which has not been clearly enough communicated yet, although it was touched upon, when recycling plastic on a high level and replace virgin in the same application, you automatically save 30 to 40% CO2 emission. There's no value for the CO2 emission savings. So where the polluter pays, here is a driver which could push the recycling market. Meanwhile, we work with volunteers all over the world, so nobody gets a salary in our organization. We have people working together with us all around the planet. Here you see some of the things we are looking at. So we are trying to make iconic products, and I will show you a few of them. So here are a few iconic products. Behind me, you also see a few iconic products. So this white wheelchair used to be a fishing gear. So we turn things into something impossible. Here you see a luxury watch, which actually use recyclate in their top brands. So you see that the fear of having recyclate as part of your product is disappearing, and that's the good thing. And people are branding more and more. We have started to clean up the largest rivers in Europe. The Danube is the second largest river, crossing 14 European countries. And we started all the way from the source, and we are moving down to the Black Sea area, which is one of the most polluted seas in Europe. We are looking at what comes out of it. What can we do to clean up? So here are a few pictures of some of the cleanups we are doing. Always with locals, we try to get the youngsters on board, but especially the local and the regional ones, and we try to make that happen. The picture on the left, as I told you, I come from the Netherlands. We have a very well organized waste management system, and still we get litter out of our rivers and out of our canals. So it's not to do with finger pointing to countries which are poorer. Even in rich countries like ours, we have litter issues, and not too small. What it also did, it brought us in together with, let's say, wildlife protection and wildlife restoration. So here you see us in the middle of a UNESCO area releasing seals together with fishermen. And as you can see over those cages, there is a fishing gear because there's a lot of entanglement of animals. So there are three very proud fishermen proud to release formerly entangled seals back to wildlife as part of a solution. And this was national television. And they said this is the first time ever that we had a good publicity on the television. So let us be part of a solution. Let us work with you to prevent these nets from coming into the water. Here, another example. This is a producer of a packaging who has gone from 100% virgin PET to 100% recycled PET. And they even included about 10% of the material we collected out of the Danube and processed back into raw material. And 5 years ago, this was impossible. Now they are proud to even put it on their packaging that they are part of a solution. So we see this happening. Talking about the blue economy, fishing gear, of course, is a very important one. So I'm also involved in the construction and the operating of this factory in Denmark. We turn fishing gear, obsolete fishing gear and maritime ropes back into raw materials. You see, this is heavy equipment. This is something else than just recycling a PET bottle. I've been involved in the first bottle-to-bottle PET recycling factory in Europe, by the way. This is the inside of the factory. It's a 25 million euro investment, but it's working. And here's some products which we just made out of fishing gear. So completely think something else. If you understand plastic, and this is also a call to all the converters in the call, the biggest challenge we have is to change our mentality and our mindset. The last 20 centimeters, it's between the ears. Just try, error, and make it happen. There was a call for uptake of recyclate. I can only support that. In most applications, you can at least use 20 or 30% recyclate. You don't always have to go to 100, but start doing it. Start learning it. Start working together with your supply chain and make it happen. We even made fishing gear by micronization into rotor molding seats for kindergartens. I mean, this was impossible. And if you give the data sheets to the converters, they say, we can't do it. And we did it. So also let that be one. Think out of box. And then after 7 years of hard work, try and error, we finally managed to go back from an obsolete marathon rope into a next generation new rope. We closed the circular loop. It took 7 years of development and try and error, but the qualities of the recyclate are of that level that we can do it. So on the bottom end, you see the circular ropes. I got a piece in my hand here as well. And now, of course, we urge the maritime sector to start uptaking these kind of products as well in their supply chain. A few last sleets. There are some products which are difficult to recycle. Nevertheless, we managed to make, for example, plates out of it, which could replace plywood, which, for example, in hurricane seasons is possible. Some of these are also in refugee camps, by the way. So instead of having people living on the landfill, we can turn the landfill into a living area. A project in Jordan near to the refugee camps. If you can see on the bottom, you can see it's a sandwich panel. So in the middle, you have materials which are slightly difficult to recycle. And on the outside, you have 100% mono recycled materials. 100% recycled, 100% recyclable, and it will go on for years. We also have contacts, of course, in India. We are in close contact with AfroShah, which some of you will certainly know. We are trying to do that also with other organizations in India, because if you see what's happening there, there's no need for all that material to be on the street. This is valuable raw material. We better have to work on the infrastructure of collection. We started earlier this year, although COVID, of course, has restricted us, into a roadshow in Africa. So we started earlier this year in March in the Ivory Coast. We are now, actually tomorrow, we are a kickoff in Cameroon. Of course, we have to do it from our offices here, and we have people on the street. If you look how much waste is on the floors and on the ground in nature in Africa, there's a big need to put extra action there. So we try to go all around Africa as a first one. Next year probably will be much bigger. And we work, of course, together with the local ones. We have sent some tools to actually do some cleanups in the rivers. And of course, this material we will start to process also into new applications. And then the final one, I think that's a movie, so I close this one with it. I think it's just a minute.